It's always quite natural for me that after I've finished a body of work, I'll already be thinking about where my writing's heading next, because I write all the time. I concentrate on word writing all the time, every day. So it's an ongoing thing. It's not like that every project is separate. They kind of roll into each other. But after White Chalk, I did give a lot of thought to where I needed to head next, and I didn't know for quite a while. In fact, I remember it being a time of that I felt quite nervous. I didn't know where I should be heading next with my work, with my writing. And I've always been very affected by what's going on in the world, politically, socially, in every way. But I'd never felt that I'd reached the place with my writing that I could talk about these things well in a language that would work. Because I think if you're going to begin to talk about giant subject matter, you've got to do it well. And I didn't feel I had the skill as a writer to do that up until this point. And then I suppose because I'm a bit older now, I've been working at songwriting for a long, long time. I felt that it might be the time to begin to try to see if it was possible, and I didn't know if it was, and I didn't know if I could do it well. But my writing's changed quite a lot over the last 4 or 5 years, in that I work on words entirely separately from music and spend a long time making a word form work on a page, and it might be a poem to be read, or it might become a song, or it might remain a piece of prose. But that's the starting point, and I found that it actually does strengthen my songs if they become songs, because they have to work at that very root level, and it has to work for somebody else to come in and just read it aloud. And so it's been a great learning curve for me, that, and helped my writing enormously. And that's how this record started, was really just concentrating on the words and wondering if I could find some way, shape or form that you could deal with the world in songs. I began to sing them before I touched an instrument. So I'd often walk and sing and walk. Sing, because at that time the words were so entrenched in my system, I knew them off by heart anyway. And I wanted the music to have an energy and a sense of being uplifting, of energising, of unifying, of gathering together of people. I knew I wanted it to be communal. So the melodies had to be something that were conducive to wanting to sing along with. So that's how it started, was singing the words. And many voices could sing those words. And the music had to be, like I said, uplifting. That was the starting point, really. And also I wanted it to be quite indefinable, quite unable to be pinned down, not particularly rooted, but of great movement. And I ended up using instruments like the autoharp and the guitar, but heavily affected guitar. So it is almost a wash of fluidity. And now those were the main instruments upon which I wrote, as well as for the voice and writing for many voices. We were in a 19th century church in Dorset that overlooked the sea, and it really was quite remote, but lent itself wonderfully acoustically, obviously, but also in terms of focus, because it was far away from any distractions. And we recorded very quickly. It was all done in 5 weeks, and we were playing the songs live, so I was often putting the voice down live as well as playing the instrument. Mick, Harvey and John Parrish and myself were the main three. Jean-Marc Butty, the drummer, he came in at a later stage, but Mick, Harvey and John also drum and play everything, really. So they were swapping between instruments, and we all were. And it had a great excitement about it, because none of us had played the songs together before. I knew how they went because I'd written them, but they didn't know how the songs went. And often you can hear John and Mick finding their way into the song, particularly a song like Glorious Land. You can hear Mick is actually working out what he's playing as he's going along, but that also has a great energy to it.